The next session, that is on trying to combine McStas and native. The slides actually from Torben from the ESS have more or less been just copied here directly, so it might be that there's an issue with some of them, but we shall see. So the idea is that we want to combine, let's say, an instrument that has a neutron transport from the source all the way to the detector, and then take that process through the kind of reduction and analysis that you could do on actual measured data. And of course the focus here of McStas, that is from the source through the detector, whereas magnetic actually in some sense starts at the detector. So what we'll be able to compare is what you've been doing all week, which is to transport through McStas, perhaps do some plots, and maybe even do some close processing on those data. And then that all of that, let's say the remaining workflow out after the transport is something you can then do in magnetic instead. Meaning that all the plots will be accessible, all the neutron data will be accessible in instead. So kind of the motivation to do this is the possibility to combine the reduction framework and the neutron transport framework to allow you to do neutron transport reduction and analysis in one go. Look at your McStas data invented, meaning the kind of data you saw already on histograms. Import McStas event information to events invented. And then this will allow to use the already developed and tested algorithms in MANTIS for the processing of data. And for the future, we are hoping that perhaps this could be used to quantify or maybe even remove. That's a little speculative, because then your simulation needs to be really perfect. But it might be, if you have a spurious signal, you can quantify that from the simulation, and you can use that in the reduction process. So to illustrate this, we will look at a simple small angle scattering machine. So we have a SANS instrument, a tutorial. Oops, that is an SMS I have to respond to. So my family wants to phone me, and they will have to wait. So So we're looking at a simplified small angle scattering machine. There's a source, a couple of slits, a sample, and a detector. That's about as simple as you can do. And what this would look like in MSS, you already saw that. This is a little hard to see. Maybe it's not. We can choose one or the other, so we can have a look at the GUI as usual. It's there. And you can get the kind of output that you've been seeing all week, meaning histograms, one or two dimensional ones, and the view of the instrument. That's kind of the normal way of seeing things in MSS. And what this will be in MANTIS is essentially the normal MANTIS graphical user interface, access to the histograms, and then also the event information in the instrument view within MANTIS. So kind of the same type of three-dimensional information which is in your MC display. And as it turns out, MC display is actually kind of key here. So here's another special use where you can do something that is not as easily done with MXTAS at all. If you have some sort of order in your small language category, you'll be able to express this by means of a two-dimensional scattering curve from the SAS neural package that goes in our simulated instruments. And then, in fact, you can do the data reduction on this and you can retrieve the same model in SAS view. So that's kind of a closed loop all the way from model through simulation, reduction and analysis. So what we use to enable this is the Nexus file format. And it has to be constructed in a special way. So for Manti to be able to decipher the information, the event, the McStas created Nexus file must contain event data, meaning that each neutron has a pixel identifier and a timestamp. So Manti has essentially only the necessary information to establish a KI and a KF around the center position, and then a pixel, essentially by means of a pixel identifier. So the key objects or elements in the instrument is the source, it's the center position, and it's the pixel element. And actually, MC display, as you've seen, is a utility that allows you to visualize the instrument, so it's a geometry engine of a kind. And, admittedly, I personally think it's a little bit of a hack, but it works. I've modified MC display to write the kind of instrument definition file, which is a nasty XML file, which is what Manti uses to describe the instrument. Yes, so if we look at the information in the file, it's not too easy to see. You have a hierarchical structure in the file that contains two things that are key here. And I think this is on the, what does it say? It says they, can't see the exact URL here, but we'll find out when we run the simulations. But there's a table of the events in here. So there's an identifier for the different events, position identifiers and so forth. So that is where the event information goes. And then inside instrument XML here, there's a data field that actually contains this auto-generated XML. So it's a direct mapping of what was in the McStas instrument file to what would be in the Manti instrument file. Good. So this is basically the same as I said before. The Manti instrument definition file stores geometry information to use in the time of flight analysis, and this implies passing information about where the neutron source is, where the sample is, and where each individual pixel of the detector is. In other words, to establish a KI and a KF. Good. So the online documentation for how to do this, that can be found through a link, which is up here. So essentially on the wiki, McStas, McStas wiki, there's a page on McStas analysis. This is what you see down here, and this is what we will be following in the exercise. What is also available is once you load the data into Manti, there's actually the usual Manti-oriented documentation is also in place to explain about this. And finally, there's a paper if you want to know further details. We put a copy on the archive. Good. So, what you need to do to your instrument file to enable this is a special operation. A key point is that the instrument file name and the internal defined instrument naming has to be identical. That's a technicality. It's because otherwise the instrument will actually try to embed a file that may not be there. So the thing is, MC display and the internals of the simulation code is not completely connected. So that's one part of the hack we need to put together. So if the file is template-sans-magic.insta, it has to be called template-sans-magic, matching case and everything. Further, you need to identify to match it where the source is in the instrument. So that could be the relevant label for that is source in small and then match it with the capital N here. And in fact, this can be an arm that you add. It need not be the physical source. One good example of that is in the case of a curved guide, because Manti actually doesn't have curved flight paths. It only thinks of distances. So to put in the correct specification of the source for use of Manti, you would take the orientation of the last guide element, and then you would go backward directly, corresponding to the length of your curved object. So that's another little special thing. Otherwise, I mean, what you will get is systematically wrong. So the orientation is shifting. In the same way, you need to identify where you think the sample is. So this is now establishing distance from source to sample. And then there's a special syntax to let our Swiss Army knife monitor NV generate the event data. And the naming here also has to be done in a specific way. It's NV mounted and then one through whatever number of panels you will have on your detector.
Good. So I don't know if you can all see that, as a matter of fact.
Kind of, maybe a bit. So here is two instruments that are actually in your normal McStas installation. There's the template sans, and there's the template sans mounted. And here you see the differences between them. The names correspond, so this means on this side it's template sans mounted. This source is now source mounted. This sample is now sample mounted. And then actually there's another thing added here, which is for normalization purposes. We'll come back to what exactly that means. It's essentially to define the spectrum, to quantify or normalize your scatter intensity. Good. And finally, at the end, we've exchanged what is normally just a PSD by a monitor ND that measures with options mounted. So that's a new keyword, you didn't see that before. Then something about the geometry. So it's square. And it measures x limits minus 3 to also minus 30 to 30 centimeters. That's the same over there. In 128 bits. That's actually the same as over there. The same for y. So it measures x and y. We have an x and y pixelation of this panel. And what it will further store is the neutron pixel ID. So this is something McStas generates automatically for you, and is written into the XML definition when MC display loads. So this means whenever a neutron arrives at this detector, we will store which pixel and get the pixel identifier. We will store time, and we will list all neutron information. So instead of creating a histogram, it's now a list of events tied to their pixel. Good. Then about how to actually run this. This becomes very technical, but in fact you need to compile with Nexus libraries. So your McStas simulation has to be Nexus aware, and that is not completely trivial. On Linux, it's sort of easy. On Windows, I provide a set of binaries together with McStas that you can install, and it should also work. And on the Mac, it's a complete nightmare, unfortunately. That's how it is. Anyway, that's the reason that I've started passing around a virtual machine, because then it's a controlled environment, and we're sure that you can start to do some work with it. Yeah, but the thing is, you need to go in the configuration dialog, and then depending on the platform, you have to tell the compiler, in this case GCC, that maybe, I don't know if you can read the last one here, that's the simplest one, that's on a Linux system. These are the normal McStas flags of enable debugging, optimization level 2, linked with the math library, and then a define saying use Nexus, and link with Nexus. That's essentially all we need to do. And then a subsequent run can generate a Nexus. Good. So these are examples of the detector geometries that we've so far enabled. You just saw the syntax for a flat panel like this in the sans geometry. You can also easily do a banana-shaped pattern. And you can of course do combinations of these, so multiple banana-shaped panels or multiple rectangular geometries, no problem. Then we've also enabled the possibility to have something really obscure if you want. So you can in fact use one of these OFF geometry format that was discussed in connection with the samples. You can define a surface simply with little polygons, and then the polygons will become pixels. And that's substantially slower than the other ones for a good reason. On the other hand, is there as a fallback if people define something which is really non-standard, we have a way to work with that. Good. So this is actually a comparison from within the MANTIP between an experimental dataset and a MANTIP dataset. And this is work by Celine Dion at ESS and her SNS collaborators. So working in the power chain geometry. Another one here is for the V20 ESS test beamline in Berlin, which is a really simple beamline, but realizing the kind of pulse features that we would have in ESS. That's a small diffraction experiment that they have. Good. So what this should enable you to do is to more easily post-process event data than making a completely new component. Because of course you could actually do a component, as you've seen in MacStas, various neutral parameters are available. One example of that, you and I actually discussed that yesterday, the monitor, which is called SQQ Omega, or something like that. In fact, measures a KI and a KF to reconstruct from the sample perspective what the momentum and energy transfer is. So that's actually kind of a data reduction, but built into a component. This gives you access to the full MANTIP framework to do things that are simple. Yes. So to do these things, what you will typically need is to do a rebuilding to a histogram of the event data. You can decide to select only some of the detectors to quantify these. And by the way, what you have access to is all of the different algorithms or methods that are available. And in fact, it allows you to process your MacStas data as if they were experimental data. Okay, that's it. So alongside the presentation on GitHub, there is a set of slides here. Only three of these. They kept in this as the sign. Put them all on this one in just a second. Come on. I'll just do it again. Here we are. Yeah. So I didn't actually bother to put these in the right formatting and everything, so they have an ESS logo on them, that's life. But the exercise is formulated in that. And essentially, you will work with the wiki documentation for the MacStas MANTIP interface, and you will try to reproduce some of the graphics which is available in that. And essentially, you will put some of the MacStas keywords that I explained to you, meaning definition of the source and the sample and the special detector. This you will put in the SAS machine, run a simulation and load it into MANTIP, and that's it for me. So two slides with information. Yeah, that's it for the exercise. So let's go.
Do we need to download the MANTIP?
No, so the virtual machine has a MANTIP inside.
Okay.
An Nexus and an Nexus.